Welcome to Our Interesting Times with host Timothy Kelley, who interviews today's top alternative and revisionist thinkers.
May you live in interesting times.
Welcome to another episode of Our Interesting Times. My guest today is Douglas Valentine. He is an investigative journalist, historian, and poet, best known for his books on the CIA's Phoenix Program and the War on Drugs. His most recent book is The CIA as Organized Crime, How Illegal Operations Corrupt America and the World, a collection of excerpts from Doug's books, published articles, and transcripts of several interviews on a range of historical and current topics that shed light on the systemic and societal corruption created by the CIA's covert operations. Doug, how are you doing today?
I'm doing good. Thanks for having me on your show.
Well, thank you for coming on. And, well, you usually start these interviews off with a couple anecdotes involving your father and how some of the things he either told you or demonstrated to you, which informed your view of the world and kind of explained to you how the world really works. Can you share that with us today?
Yes. I basically owe my writing career to my father, and a lot of my insights into the world. My father was a World War II veteran, and he was in combat, and he was also a prisoner of war in the Philippines. But and I'm a product of the post-war baby boom. I was born in 1949. So I grew up in the 50s and the 60s. And my father was also a blue-collar working-class guy. He worked for a company called Railway Express. He drove a truck, kind of like UPS nowadays or FedEx back in the 50s and 60s. And he also always worked a second job, and he ran the movie theater in town at night for a while, and then later on he worked in a liquor store. So he basically worked himself to death. And my mother she also had a job. So I didn't get a lot of attention from my father, but periodically he would give me little lessons in life. And as a guy who'd been in combat and a prisoner of war, he just had good insights into things. And the first lesson he gave me, I was about 18, and I was home in the summer, and I was working for a tree company. And I climbed trees for much of my young life. From 1967 to 1979, I was a blue-collar worker myself, climbing trees. And I was working in the same town where I grew up with my father, in Pleasantville, New York. And I would see him in the local diner at breakfast. He was working in the post office at that time, and he was working the graveyard shift. And he would get off of work, and he would go to the diner to get a cup of coffee before he went home. And I'd be going to work, and I'd meet him there. But he would sit on one side of this diner with all the cops and the older men, and I would sit on the other side with my friends. This was during the generation gap days. I don't know how old your audience is, but if they're as old as me, you know, they'll remember those days. Otherwise, I don't know that young people today would be able to relate to that, but there was a real generation gap. And the World War II guys, like my father, were very proud of having fought in the war, and they had won that war, and Vietnam was going on. And there was kids my age, guys my age, were resisting the war. And so there was just a lot of conflict between the men, the older men and the younger men in those days. I don't think there's that really exists so much today. But anyway, that's the context. And one day we met in the diner, and he said, I want you to come to town and meet me by the bank an hour early tomorrow morning. And even though we didn't like each other, he was still my father, so I always did what he said, which may be another difference between kids today and their parents. Back then, even if you didn't like your mother and father, you did exactly what they said. And anyway, so the next morning I met him at the bank, and it's just a little town, Pleasantville, and we walked down the main street, and there was nobody was up yet. The sun was just coming up, and we walked around the corner and up towards where this little diner was, and there was two vehicles parked in front of it. One of the vehicles was a bread truck, and it there was a the name on it was, you know, recognizable to me. I won't name it, but it was the bread truck, and the owner of the of this little diner, his car was parked there. And I didn't know what was going on, but my father walked into the street behind this bread truck, delivery truck, and I was trailing behind him, and he flung open the doors to this bread truck, and inside was the bread truck delivery man, Italian guy. It was an Italian company, and the owner of the this diner were sitting in the front. And in the back of it, amongst all the donuts and loaves of bread and cupcakes and stuff, were three Pleasantville cops, all of whom I knew. I went to school with their kids. I knew them by their first name. I had known them all my life. And they were passing betting slips and money back and forth amongst the three of them and tallying up the numbers. And they all their mouths fell open, and they looked at me and my father, and my father said, "Doug, take a good look. This is the true relationship between crime and law enforcement." I closed the doors, and I went about my business, and he went about his business, and I never really thought about it. Like a couple of days later, it was like a weekend, and I had been out drinking, and it was like 2 o'clock in the morning, and I ran a red light in the middle of Pleasantville, and one of the cops who was in that bread truck pulled me over, and he said, "Don't you think you should be going home, Doug? You know, don't you, you know, take care." You know, I mean, it was like nothing had happened. Like there's, I had been initiated into some sort of secret club, but It didn't, there wasn't a ripple, and that didn't affect anything. You know, I mean, I went back to the diner and nobody looked at me askance, or I had just been, all of a sudden I knew what was going on. And it, I had to think about that event for many, many years before it actually sank in and before I was able to apply that lesson to other things. And, but it did change my worldview, and it was a peek into the way things really work. I'm sure to this day that 99% of the people that lived in Pleasantville had never seen anything like that in their lives. They think the cop pulls you over if you're speeding, and that's all they think about how our society and our culture is structured. But obviously, it was a little seed of doubt that was planted in my mind. That happened, like I said, when I was about 18. When I was 30, my father had his second open heart surgery. This was in 1980. And he and I hadn't spoken together for about 10 years. We really didn't like each other. He'd had his first open heart surgery when he was 45. And it had really disrupted his life. In those days, he had open heart surgery. That was like 1972. It was still experimental, open heart surgery in those days. And when he had his second open heart surgery, 1980, he was on death's doorstep. And he was in the hospital in the intensive care room, and he was having terrible nightmares. And his nightmares were so bad that they had to put him in a room by himself, and they sent the hospital psychiatrist in to see him because his nightmares were all about the war, about World War II and the terrible things that had happened in World War II. And the psychiatrist told him if he was ever going to get better, he had to tell me, he had to tell somebody what had happened in the war. And so he called me up, and I was living in New Hampshire, and he said, "You got to come on home, Doug. I got a story to tell you." And he told me about his experiences as a prisoner of war and how he'd been in a POW camp where the prisoners had actually mutinied against their officers. And it became the subject of my first book, which is called The Hotel Tacloban. And that really also awakened me to what goes on behind the scenes and the stories that our government and our military tell us about who we are and what we are and what really goes on secretly behind the scenes. My father and the guys that had mutinied were told, if they ever revealed the secret, that there had been a mutiny in this camp, and that the enlisted men had killed one of their officers, that they would all be put up in front of a firing squad and shot. So my father had been forced by the government to keep this terrible secret. And I came to understand that was why he had worked himself to death. That was why he had a heart attack at the age of 45. And a second open heart surgery at the age of 55. Not only he had fought for his country in good faith, put his life on the line, and because of the terrible things that happened in war, the government had squeezed him. You know, instead of being honored, he'd been basically blackmailed, and it had caused him, he had terrible, terrible PTSD. So this was in 1980, and I took a couple of years off, and I wrote that book with him. And coupled with that experience I'd had when I was much younger with the police, and now knowing that the government could cover up the existence of a POW camp, let alone just the relationship that cops have protecting the mafia in town and in every city that across the country, what happened in Pleasantville with the cops and the bookies happens everywhere, every day, all around the country. You just don't know about it. And what happens in war, likewise, the terrible things that happen in war, you don't know about. Instead, soldiers are sent out to fight and they go through terrible experiences and they come home and they suffer for it. But the true nature of war is something that Americans don't really understand. We haven't had wars here on our property, on our territory. We go overseas and we fight wars. And so it makes it a little bit easier not to talk about it. And the realities of war are somewhat distant to us. And it's much easier for the government to make soldiers into heroes and to glorify war, because we here don't experience it. So after that first book of mine came out in 1984, and that's called The Hotel Tacloban, And I had finally formed the relationship with my father based in honesty, him being honest with me about why he felt the way he felt about things and the horrible things he had experienced. And once he had gotten all that stuff off his chest, we were able to have a normal relationship. And that really inspired me, and I decided I would write a book about the Vietnam War, which was the determinant thing in my generation. And I took that book, The Hotel Talk Globe, and I went around to different veterans, and I told them what, gave them the book to read, and I went to one veterans organization in New Hampshire where I was living. I went to a veterans hospital, and I gave the director of the hospital the book, and I said, did anything like this happen in Vietnam? I wanted to write about an aspect of the Vietnam War that nobody had written about before. And right away, he said, the Phoenix Program, which I had never heard about. Frankly, I didn't know much about the Vietnam War at all, like most people. And I said, well, what's the Phoenix Program? And he said, well, I got a guy here in the VA hospital who was in the U.S. Army Special Forces. And he told me he was in the Phoenix Program, and he told me a little bit about it. And I'll arrange an interview with you with this guy, and he can tell you about the Phoenix Program. And I said, great. Anyway, he called me up a couple of days later, and he said, the guy won't talk to you. And I said, well, why not? And it was the exact same thing as with my father. He said, the guy's afraid the military will cut off his VA benefits if he tells you about the Phoenix Program. It's a secret program, and he had a sign a non-disclosure statement that he wouldn't talk about it and all the horrible things that happened. And so forget it. He won't talk to you. And that just made me more determined than ever to find out, what the hell is this Phoenix Program, and why won't veterans talk about it? Why? How can you be serve your country, go off and fight its wars, come home damaged with PTSD or your parts of your body blown off, and fear the government and fear telling what happened and what the truth is? And it just fit into this growing philosophy and understanding I had of how there's such a big disconnect between what we're told about the world in the media and in our history books, and even by people who participate in events overseas, and it's actually what really, really happened, and why there is censorship. So I took this book to Hotel Talk Globe, and I read up a little bit about the Phoenix Program. And I found out that there was a guy named William Colby who'd been head of at one time the CIA, and he had run this Phoenix Program in Vietnam, and he had come home in 1971 to the United States, and he had defended the CIA and the Phoenix Program in front of Congress. There had been congressional hearings about it. And he was the person, Colby, that was most associated with the Phoenix Program. And not having gone to the Columbia School of Journalism, having been a tree surgeon for 10 years and a blue collar kid who'd been a college dropout, I just had a talent for writing. I wasn't intimidated, and I didn't know that you're not supposed to approach the director of the CIA. And I just, you know, that, and if you do, you're supposed to go on bended knee with all sorts of presents and gifts and stuff, you know. And I just sent him a copy of the book. And I said, hey, Mr. Colby, I'd like to write about the Phoenix Program. Will you give me an interview? And he read this book, The Hotel Talk Globe, and he said, yeah, sure. You'll understand what it means. You understand what it means to be a soldier. You understand the realities, and I can tell you, and I think you'll understand. And he took a realistic approach to it, and he knew I was from nowhere, and he liked that too. He liked a lot of the CIA guys I met through Colby, liked the fact that I wasn't from Yale or Harvard or something. You know, the CIA guys meet all these, you know, yuck-em-up journalists that you see on TV in their suits and their ties, and they all have these, you know, bloated egos about themselves. And here I was, just a working-class kid who had reconciled with my father. And again, these CIA guys were from the World War II generation. Most of them had fought in World War II. Colby had parachuted into France, and a lot of them read this book and they thought, this kid understands. This guy will understand what I tell him. And because Colby got behind me and sent me to him, they all started telling me their deepest, darkest secrets. And it's funny because I never asked anybody anything lurid. I approached the Phoenix program and the study of it purely from an organizational point of view. I asked them, you know, who was your boss? What was your job? How did you go about doing your job? And I just approached it very rationally and without any kind of, I never asked anybody, did you kill somebody or did you torture somebody or nothing like that. And yet in the course of having these long and mostly tape recorded a bunch of them, and the tape recorded interviews are up on the internet if anybody wants to read them, listen to them. But a lot of these conversations, I just ask very organizationally structured questions. And in the process of it, they would tell me anecdotes. And those anecdotes were very revealing. The anecdotes were revealing in the same way my anecdote about the police protecting the bookies in Pleasantville was revealing. Or they were anecdotal in the same sense that, you know, my father telling me about what really happens in a POW camp, as opposed to the, you know, sort of Bruce Willis, Robert Mitchum version of war that you get in the movies and on TV. What really goes on in war is just so different from what you hear. And these guys were just telling me what it really means to be a CIA officer, apart from the organizational stuff. And they felt that they could tell me and that I would understand because of this book and my relationship with my father. But at the same time, and I'm a good interviewer, and I kept a straight face towards it throughout all this stuff. The things they were telling me were horrifying. I mean, absolutely making me nauseous at times. And I had to sit there and just be, you know, deadpan and yes, Mr. This, yes, Mr. That, you know, and then what happened. And yet it, going through this experience and learning about the CIA, I was actually coming down on a case of PTSD myself. I mean, it was traumatic just hearing the nonchalant way these guys would talk about, for example, one guy said that he had been in Da Nang and he worked with the special secret police that they had in Da Nang, and they would get information, and this was a big facet of the Phoenix program. They had informants that they sent out all over in the area, and the informants would report back on members of what the CIA called the Viet Cong infrastructure. These were not members of the Viet Cong. Not the soldiers, the guerrillas who were fighting the Americans, but the civilians that were supporting them. The CIA called these civilians the Viet Cong infrastructure. These were the people that would like run a message between one town and the next town, or maybe would carry money from one town to the next town, or maybe it was a secret agent who, a woman, let's say, who was in the Farmers Association or the Teachers Association. There was, you know, at least in some places like Da Nang in the north in Vietnam, 75% of the people supported the Viet Cong. And it was their support, the support of these civilians who were secretly supporting the guerrillas, that was really driving the CIA crazy. That's and the CIA's Phoenix program was designed to go out and get these people, the civilians who were supporting the guerrillas. That's why it's a CIA program and not a military program. The military might burn down a village and kill a bunch of people, but that's not the intention. That just happens because that's the way the military rolls and when they're fighting a counterinsurgency. They don't distinguish between the soldiers and the civilians. I mean, that's the way it is in every war, believe me, not just Vietnam. But the CIA is different than the military in that it goes after civilians. That's its job, to get the leaders of the civilian insurgency. And so one CIA guy, his name was Bob Wall, and he was one of the guys that created the Phoenix program, was just wanted to tell me how cute the CIA could be. And he said him and another guy named Rip Robertson found out that a bunch of these civilians met in a open air market, and that's where they would exchange their messages, and under cover of a farmer's market. And of course, in rural Vietnam, that's how people do business. You know, I mean, it's all like a big farmer's market, and they would come in and have kind of a festive atmosphere at the market, and there were Japanese lanterns strung all around the marketplace. And this guy, CIA officer Bob Wall, was telling me about this other CIA officer, Rip Robertson, who he held in very high regard, went around and clandestinely put C4 cartridges in all these Japanese lanterns that were strung over this marketplace. And they had people watching, and when they were sure, all the civilians who were part of this Viet Cong infrastructure were there in the marketplace, they set them off, and they just blew everybody up in this marketplace. Kids, old people, anybody. And the whole idea was to terrorize the population. Not to terrorize the guerrillas, because, you know, they're soldiers. You can't terrorize another soldier. You know, I mean, soldiers, they're terrorized anyway. You know, they're just going out and they're fighting, you know. I mean, they wanted to terrorize the civilians so that they would no longer support them. And that's what the CIA did. And that's the Phoenix program in a nutshell. And the strange thing was, after this interview was over, I tell you, I was feeling queasy. It wasn't easy to keep a poker face or to pretend that you like somebody and are interested when you're hearing this stuff, but it was going on over and over and over and over again. And we were standing in his garage, and it was the afternoon, and we're saying goodbye. My car was parked out in the driveway, you know, but he had gone. He had like a ranch, split-level ranch, and we had gone down into the basement, and we're going out through the garage, and we're standing there, and he said, by the way, we're aware at the CIA what you're doing. You know, we know you're writing this book, you know, that it may not really be as favorable to us as we would like it to be. And he said, I run a youth leadership program, and what we would like to do is invite you into this youth leadership program, and we'll get you a job as a staff researcher on the Senate Armed Services Committee. He said, you'll start at a fantastic amount of money every year. And this is like 1987. And I seem to remember, he said I would be starting at $80,000 a year as a researcher. I said, well, thanks, Mr. Wall, but I prefer to work for myself. And, I went home and I told my wife and I told my father, and they both said, you're crazy. You should take the damn job, man. You know, you'd be set for life, you know. And they were both willing to sell out in a second. But I say that kind of facetiously, folks. Okay, I mean, like everybody else, you know, the candy, when they dangle the candy in front of you, it's hard to say no, you know. And your first instinct is, now I understand why everybody sells out. And that's exactly, you know, but I turned them down, and it was at that point, around that point, that they started keeping a file on me, which is also up on the internet for anybody to see. The CIA kept a file on me, and I got access to it through a Privacy Act request, which I filed right around that time. Once people started telling me, the CIA guys started telling me, well, you know what you're up to. You know, I realized that things were going on. I filed a Privacy Act request. It took me like 5 or 6 years to get my file from the CIA. The ACLU represented me. And I finally got it. And it's up on the internet. You can look at it at my website, www.douglasvalentine.com. It's also attached to an article that came out last week at Counterpunch. But they were talking about me, and they were, and one of the documents, they called me Bad News Valentine. You know, I mean, it's fun. They said I had acquired so much information that I could damage the CIA. But they did their best to try to prevent that book from coming out, and it's to the extent that they actually offered a job, and actually, you know, I mean, it was actually a way of recruiting me into the CIA. You know, I mean, I would have been a staff person on a Senate committee, but I would have owed my soul to the CIA, and I already would have known where my orders were coming from. And believe me when I tell you, there's a hell of a lot of people working for congressional committees who have gotten onto those committees because they took this deal, and which is another reason why you really don't know what's going on. And there's plenty of journalists who have been offered this deal by CIA officers who have taken it. One of whom is a guy named Morley Safer, who's the guy who wrote the review for the New York Times about my book, The Phoenix Program, which came out in 1990. And when it came out in 1990, I knew I was going to get slammed. I mean, it was not the book that Colby had thought I was going to write. And he and all the CIA officers that I interviewed, they all felt a little betrayed by me, because even though I had gone in with my mind open and was curious to hear what they had to say, they said they destroyed themselves by actually telling me the truth about what they do. You know, I mean, and when I found out how horrific it was and I wrote about it, they were upset because I was supposed to, like all the regular writers who are out there writing about the CIA and all the other journalists who are out there reporting about the CIA, I was supposed to be one of the old boys who kept the secrets. Well, I didn't do it because, frankly, I feel you and your readers and everybody in America has the right to know, and that it's the CIA and this secrecy that's corrupting America and making America believe and assume things that are false. And they'll go down roads and affect policies that are detrimental to all of American citizens because they don't get the truth. Anyway, when it came time to write the review in the New York Times of my book, about my book in 1990, first of all, the usual method is just to ignore a book like my book, The Phoenix Program. I mean, people write about the CIA. If they don't say what they're supposed to say and what's approved, the general rule is just to ignore it, call it a conspiracy theory, you know, say the guy had, you know, sour grapes, or, you know, he's a disgruntled employee or whatever. But they were really mad at me. So they gave Morley, the New York Times, arranged for Morley Safer to have a half page to destroy my book in the New York Times, which was very unusual, except for the fact that the New York Times book review section teaches the intelligentsia in America what to think. It tells them what to think and how to say it. And they were using this review to inform everybody how to really think about the Phoenix Program. And people like me, who have the temerity to actually reveal what was going on. And so Safer gave it a terrible review. And even though I knew the review was coming, you know, the old adage, if you blank blank with the bull, you get the horns. You know, I mean, I knew something was going to happen. It took me 25 years to find out why they chose Morley Safran. And it was only last year that a friend of mine, a guy named Thomas Wilkinson, was going through who's very interested in my work, and he was on the internet researching a guy named Negroponte who'd been in the Phoenix program, and he came across a State Department speech that Negroponte had spoken at, and Morley Safer had also spoken at this function, and when Morley Safer was talking. And this took place in 2010, although I didn't find out about it until last year. He told an anecdote, another revealing anecdote. And he said when he was in Vietnam, one day William Colby called him up and said to him, "Hey, Morley, can you disappear for 3 days? You know, ha, 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 ha." Anyway, Colby took Safer to visit all the CIA outposts in Vietnam, took him to all the interrogation centers. This is part of the Phoenix program. The CIA built an interrogation center in each of South Vietnam's 44 provinces. The interrogations were staffed by the Vietnamese special police, secret police, advised by CIA officers. The CIA officers built these at their own expense. I talk all about it in my book, including the new book. Took Safer to all the interrogations, you know, all the bases, CIA bases, introduced them all the CIA guys. Introduced them to all the counterterror teams. On the one hand, Phoenix was based on these interrogation centers where they worked people over until they revealed where the civilians were who were supporting the insurgency. And then they sent out their hit teams, the CIA hit teams, which were called counterterror teams, to go knock them off or kidnap them and generally wipe out their families, just like at that market I was telling you about. Part of the philosophy of Phoenix was not just to kill somebody, but to kill everybody they know and everybody who was around them as a warning. That was the essence of Phoenix. So Morley Safer got to see all these deepest, darkest secrets, thanks to Colby. And just like that guy, Bob Wall, felt that I would owe my soul to him because he had revealed all sorts of secrets to me. Morley Safer said at this conference in 2010 that he still felt constrained about talking about the CIA. And Colby had been effective. By giving this guy Morley Safer and insights into all the dastardly things that the CIA was doing, basically Morley Safer sold his soul to the CIA. He had been let in on what the secrets were, and he never told them. He never thought that anybody in the United States had a right to know what the CIA was up to. It was more important to him to maintain his relationship with Bill Colby as an insider so he could secretly know what was going on. And then, you know, his editors and all the publishers at New York Times, they all knew the secrets too. Just like, you know, a certain ruling class in Pleasantville knew that the cops protected the bookies. Just like a certain ruling class knows that what goes on in prisoner of war camps isn't what you see on TV, and that the enlisted men want to kill their officers for making deals with the Japanese or the Germans, that all sorts of terrible things go on that you're not supposed to talk about. Well, Morley Safer knew all those secrets, thanks to Colby, and he never told you or me or anybody else. And we're the ones that have the right to know. And when Colby was, you know, was furious about my book, the person that he went to write the review was Morley Safer. And that's how it works. And that's why you don't know what's going on. And that's why you're confused, if you're confused about what's going on. Because the CIA corrupts everybody of any worth in the media. I mean, the whole media, all the media, all the every publishing company has a guy or a gal on their editorial staff that makes sure that nothing gets out about the CIA. Every newspaper, every TV company has somebody on staff who makes sure that no reporter makes a mistake of telling you what the CIA is up to. And furthermore, the Congress, which is staffed by people who owe their soul to the CIA, just like I was asked to go join a staff, you know, they pass laws that make it illegal for you to talk about the CIA. It's illegal. You can go to prison if you name a CIA officer. You can go to prison if you tell what it is that they do. And the reason for that is because everything they do is illegal. They're the organized crime branch of the United States. Nothing they do is nice or good. And nothing they do is for your benefit. Everything they do is for the benefit of this ruling elite that's in the know and creates rules that protect secrecy so that you can't find out about it. This permeates the whole society and the whole culture. They have the CIA recently created a digital innovations division. You know, it's their fifth division. And they're applying all these philosophies and methods to how the internet is controlled, which, of course, is such a big part of our lives. And has resulted in this fake news epidemic where nobody knows anymore what's true and what isn't true. You see things, contradictory things on the news, and you really just end up not knowing what to believe anymore. And somebody like Donald Trump comes along and offers up some view of the future that, you know, is like appealing. And people flock to it because they are confused and because they just want a better life. And they feel like, especially working class people, of whom I am one, feel that their rulers have sold them down the river, which they have. But, you know, of course, the mistake is thinking that Trump, a billionaire, is somehow going to make it better. You know, I mean, and again, it takes such an effort to understand all this and put it in all perspective, to see how your life in a diner in Pleasantville, New York, reflects what's happening in Washington, D.C., or in Syria, or in Afghanistan, or in the Ukraine, how it's really no different, how it's all the same, and how it's really just this story that we're told, the story that's proved, the Hollywood story, the TV story, you know, with very few exceptions, how we come to believe it. And we base all our assumptions on this story. And in my books, based on using my own personal experience and myself as an example, I just try to show that there is another story. And that if we can break through and come to understand this other story, that we can heal ourselves, just like my father and I were able to overcome that generation gap and actually become best friends, even though we hadn't talked to each other for 10 years. But the way to actually heal and to get over the trauma and the confusion is not through constructing happy fantasies or accepting what other people tell you is true, but it's actually very seriously taking responsibility into your own hands and trying to break through and understand things. And that's like, I know I started talking about an hour ago and haven't shut up, but that's what about. And what I try to tell in my books, this book, most recent book, and the Phoenix Program book, and also my War on Drugs, is how the powers that be have systematized, using the bureaucracies, their power. It's based on what's called systems theory and how they've actually arranged the bureaucracies and so that these things are now permanently in place.
And these books are Strength of the Wolf and Strength of the Pack.
Yes.
And the two books you wrote on the Bureau of Narcotics and the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs have morphed into the Drug Enforcement Agency, which is all part of this phony war on drugs.
Absolutely, and just what the cops, the Pleasantville cops, had a relationship with the mafia in Pleasantville, New York. The CIA through the DEA has relationships with drug traffickers all over the world. They have absolutely, I mean, you do realize, I'm sure everybody knows that opium production in Afghanistan not just doubled or tripled, but went up by like 100% once the CIA moved in 2001. And Afghanistan has been providing the world with 90% of its opium and heroin for the last 15 years. This is not an oversight. This is because the CIA took over that country and took over and lets all the warlords that are on its payroll fighting the Taliban make fortunes dealing drugs.
And this is the same thing that occurred in Vietnam, right?
It's the exact same relationship that the cops had in Pleasantville. And the CIA that does this. And because the CIA, because you're not, as a reporter, allowed to name CIA officers or tell what they do, you don't know about it. Yeah. But this is exactly what's happening. And this is how, and the drug war is just one example of how the CIA has not only corrupted all these foreign countries, but by corrupting the DEA, has corrupted America too. And it's how they've corrupted our legislative branch of the government by infiltrating their little CIA nicks into all that, not only getting them elected into position as congressmen and senators, but filling up their staffs with CIA people who owe their soul and their careers to the CIA. So they very systematically and very precisely, they don't have to do it. They also need is one person on a staff, and that one person on a congressional staff is the only person who's cleared to see the important documents, and that's how they control that committee. And the congressmen aren't even aware themselves half the time that they're being tricked and that they're being used, and because the system is so permanently and deeply entrenched, and because a lot of them become our legislators because it's a chance to make an awful lot of money. And so they get corrupted and they go along with it too. But the system's rotten from top to bottom, and the CIA is at the heart of it.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, you mentioned Afghanistan. The same pattern you can recognize in the Vietnam War.
Yeah.
Where CIA makes these alliances with local drug lords to facilitate their operations, but it gets to a point where it's not just an alliance of convenience. The drug trade is a big part of their operations around the world and controlling the financial system and maintaining the financial system. Yeah,
absolutely. And of course, Laos, which is where the CIA grew all its opium, and it had what was called a secret army in Laos, headed by a guy named General Vang Pao, who made a fortune himself in the opium business. Well, the only reason it was a secret war, all the journalists knew. All the morally safers who were out there, they all knew, but they kept it quiet because they owe their careers and their livelihoods to the CIA, and their loyalty is to them. And they never reported on this huge CIA operation of bringing drugs from Laos through Thailand mostly, but sometimes directly, to all the generals in South Vietnam. I mean, the generals in South Vietnam were like the warlords in Afghanistan. They each owned a franchise, and they got kickbacks from all the drugs that were coming into their little area, their, I Corps, 2 Corps, 3 Corps, 4 Corps, Saigon, wherever. And they made fortunes, and everybody knew it was happening. And by 1970, it had gotten so bad that heroin addiction was like at 25% among soldiers in Vietnam. And again, it's blowback. By 1966, enterprising soldiers were bringing tons of that heroin back to the United States, which is why we had a heroin epidemic in the United States in the late 1960s into the 1970s, because the CIA grew all the drugs in Laos and allowed everybody to bring them into heroin to keep the generals happy, because the only way the generals would serve the CIA was as if they could make a fortune on the side. And this, it actually resulted in a heroin epidemic in the United States. All this is well known. It's just you're not allowed to. And the guy, the first guy to write a book about it, Al McCoy in Politics of Heroin in Southeast Asia, was so vilified that he had to actually move to Australia for 10 years and get out of the country. You know, if you do actually expose it, then you're vilified. You get a terrible review in the New York Times. People will never talk to you. Every other journalist knows this guy's a threat. He's on the verge of exposing that we know all the CIA secrets and we're not telling them and we're going to look bad. Say horrible things about them. Get rid of them. Make it so miserable what's the guy's name? He was actually a friend of mine.
Gary Webb.
You know, put so much pressure on them that they kill themselves. You know, and then they all get a good chuckle out of it. And believe me, they laughed when Gary Webb killed himself, the CIA people. I mean, these are vicious, vicious people who, you know, 50% of them are psychopaths and the other 50% are hired to keep the other 50% under control. Like this guy, Bob Wall, telling me about Rip Robertson. You know, half of them are the Rip Robertsons that put the C4 in the Japanese lanterns. And the other 50% about this guy like Bob Wall that wouldn't do it, but think it's funny.
Mm-hmm. Well, the drug trade itself and narcotics trafficking is so much money, hundreds of billions, if not $1 trillion annually is made through it. And, of course, this is funneled through the financial system to the West, the banking system, Wall Street. I think you touch on that in your book as well, and the role it plays in other, I guess, business modeling, like the privatized prison industrial complex. And so it's not just more than just dealing drugs. It seems to be a more sinister agenda afoot here.
Let me just set something straight right now, okay? The CIA works generally at a very high level. What happened in Vietnam, in the sense of going after so many just average rural civilians, was kind of, in a way, unusual. The best informants, assets that the CIA has are world-class bankers and arms traffickers. They're dealing at a level of Goldman Sachs, of Lockheed Martin, of the big arms and oil corporations. That's where they get their, that's where they're recruiting their best agents, is amongst bankers, top bankers, the top bankers in the world, among the top corporate presidents, and some guy who's like this guy Tillerson in Russia, who Trump has named for a State Department. If you don't think this guy has CIA connections, you're crazy. I mean, he's been reporting back to the CIA since the first day he went to Russia, and the CIA knows everything he's doing. And it's a sham to think that somehow he's doing, you know, that they're off the reservation. I mean, that's the level that the CIA works at. And so when you talk about a $300 billion business like illegal drugs, and you wonder, where does all that money go? Well, I can tell you this, the CIA knows, because it's the bankers who are laundering all this money are its payroll. That's the level that the CIA works at. I mean, again, think of the cops in Pleasantville. You know, I mean, and now think CIA, President Netanyahu. I mean, you know, they'll have Netanyahu on the payroll, and they'll have Yasser Arafat on the payroll. And both guys are, you know, are at war with each other. But the CIA doesn't care. It wants them both. It wants Putin on the payroll. It wants, the more important you are, the more important you are to the CIA and the CIA to get its claws into you. And when it comes to arms traffickers, arms manufacturers, especially foreign-owned, and bankers, especially foreign-owned, you know, bankers in the Middle East, bankers in Geneva, those are the people that the CIA really, really values as assets. And that's the level that they're working at. And a little guy like me, or rural peasants in Vietnam, were about as important to the CIA as workers in an Andrew Carnegie steel factory were to Andrew Carnegie, or an assembly line person was to Henry Ford, or any worker anywhere is to some big businessman. We're just fodder for their grist mill, and they're going to do their best to deny you health care and to keep your wages low. And it's the CIA that serves those people. They don't serve the worker on the factory line. They don't serve the guy toiling in the fields. You know, I don't care about you. You're nothing. You're meaningless. And that's another reason that the corruption is spread throughout the system, because the CIA has so much power, and they're able to, and it's all geared towards protecting the 1% of the 1%.
Yeah, I believe, here you have a quote in your book. I'm going to read it to you, because it spells out what you're talking about here, by Johan Galtung, I think.
Yes.
And he goes, "Personal violence is for the amateur in dominance. Structural violence is the tool of the professional. The amateur who wants to dominate you uses guns. The professional who wants to dominate you uses social structure. The legal criminality of the social system and the institutions of government and of individuals at the interpersonal level is tacit violence. Structural violence is the structure of exploitation and social injustice."
That's exactly it. And that's what I tried to show in the Phoenix Program book. Again, I said it's based in systems theory. The CIA has guys who graduated magna cum laude from Yale and Harvard, who understand how to structure society, how to structure bureaucracies. And it's boring to a lot of people, but I put it into the Phoenix Program book exactly how they do these things. And you know, it's like studying petrochemicals or algebra. I mean, if you really want to know this stuff, you got to go to college and study it for 3 or 4 years. So I'm just trying to summarize it. But believe me when I tell you, they have experts who have, over the last 100 years, you know, since the FBI was created and the Fed was created and all these different facets of our society to regulate it, they've been studying this stuff for 100 years. And it's distant to most people, as distant as Mars or Jupiter or Saturn. I mean, how this works. So I try to summarize it. But if you really understand, you got to understand that that's how they do it. They're not pulling a rabbit out of a hat. It's not magic. It's the science of these systems and how to organize and manage. They organize and manage our society just like I said. Henry Ford manages auto production factory.
There's indeed a science to coercion.
Yeah.
This is why the CIA were hire anthropologists, psychologists, people from Madison Avenue, like Ed Lansdale, correct?
Every facet. Yeah. And this was one of the things that was to my advantage, is because, and I said this in the book, I mean, even all those years when I was doing tree work, I was still reading. I was reading a lot of literature. I read the Russians. You know, I mean, I was a tree surgeon by day, but I was trying to understand literature, you know, by night. And I read a lot of literary criticism, and I looked at literature and how language affects the way we view the world from a lot of different points of view, philosophical, anthropological, psychological, sociological. I mean, all those different things were of interest to me. And so I had a broad view, and that helped me personally to understand this stuff. But you really do need, it really becomes important to see it from all the problem from all these different points of view, because the CIA has the greatest experts in each one of these little things, each one of these areas. bringing the absolute, the latest technology, the best computer people, the best sociologists, the best anthropologists. And then above them, it has managers, people who understand how to put all this stuff together and coordinate it, and how to keep it secret. And cops, guys who've been to college, get PhD levels in law enforcement. Soldiers who study at the National War College and know all the intricacies of logistics and how to fight a war. All those people and all the things they know, the CIA manages them all and keeps the most important clues secret. And its firewall is the medium. And it's almost a mistake nowadays to think of the media and the CIA as two different things. In fact, it is a mistake to think of the media and the CIA as two different things. They're the same thing.
Mm-hmm. That was exposed, of course, in the 70s with Operation Mockingbird. But that's why Frank Wisner himself called it what his mighty Wurlitzer, correct?
Yeah, and that was 50 years ago.
Yes.
So, I mean, and so if you think about it, how advanced they are now in these, how much they've refined the systems. You know, I mean, back then, Mockingbird was a Toyota. What they have nowadays is the Lamborghini. You know, and they have created this web of confusion through the media. So then, and you know, which they call disingenuously fake news. So then nobody can tell any anymore what's real and what isn't real. And within that system, all you can do is rely on who you think is an authority to tell you the right thing to do.
Yeah.
That is how fascism is created. And that is where the danger, and that's exactly the situation that they've created so that people who they can present as authorities can come along, win your trust, and then steal you blind.
Mm-hmm. Well, regarding the drug war, there was a quote that I end of the book. It's in Henrik Kruger's the Great Heroin Coup. I
think that's a great book. Yeah,
I just finished that, and that's one of these books is just jam packed full of information, names. I finished the book feeling dizzy, but at the end, I think this was a postscript that he wrote years later. I think the book was written in the 1970s, and he wrote this fairly recently. And I'll just sum it up. I'll read it to you. It goes, "The United States war on drugs is a ghost war. You see it in the newspapers and on TV, and you hear about it from politicians, but it's not really there. If you look for long-term results, they don't exist. Still, there are a lot of people involved in it, some of them invisible, and some of them only visible when the smoke clears. The visible people, the real warriors, the drug war, are the DEA agents, or at least some of them. They are busy trying to roll the giant Sisyphus stone of the mountain, and the CIA and the money men make sure that it rolls back down." Sorry, reading from a Kindle.
Yeah.
"That it rolls back down again to refill the veins and noses, generating fortunes for gangsters, banksters, corrupt politicians, funding for secret and dirty wars. Unfortunately, narcotics are a very important part of the world economy. If they were removed, the economy would probably crash. Many banking systems certainly would. So the show must go on, and it does. Nobody gives an shit when the ghost goes boo. We all know it's an empty threat. Instead of fighting drugs in an honest way, the war on drugs has been used as an instrument to suppress poor and indigenous people, workers, farmers, rebellious students, and leftists in many parts of the world, especially in Latin America, and has been used as a cover for U.S. agents sent to Brazil, Uruguay, Bolivia, and other countries as torture consultants. And for many years, it has been feeding money and weapons to brutal dictatorships. It has been a groggy and ghost-ridden government, which in 2012 outsourced the war on drugs in Latin America to Soldiers of Fortune of Academy, formerly known as Blackwater and Z, which has been deeply compromised by murder and manslaughter convictions of some of its employees in Iraq. On Academy's board of directors, one finds retired Admiral Bobby Ray Inman and former deputy director of the CIA and director of the NSA. So intelligence and manipulation of the war on drugs in Latin America seems to be in experienced hands for the immediate future. The same goes for the hypocritical worldwide war on terrorism. It too cannot be taken seriously as long as right-wing terrorists like Luis Posada Carriles and Stefano Dele Chele have hundreds of gladio and condor torturers and cutthroats go free, because they are terrorists, all right, but they are terrorists.
Yep, and I'm trying to say the same thing. And,
yeah.
And in my books, Strength of the Wolf and Strength of the Pack, I tell how, blow by blow, how the CIA took over the DEA. I mean, how there's a chapter in my new book called How the CIA Commandeered the DEA. And I did this by interviewing DEA agents who told me how it happened. I mean, it's Henrik didn't interview, you know, do the kind of depth that I did. But I interviewed him. You know, I mean, I got in there and I explained it all blow by blow. And can I just close off with one more anecdote?
Certainly.
And then that would be it for me today. While I was investigating Phoenix, I kept hearing about all the CIA drug dealing out of Laos and, you know, and the Golden Triangle into Vietnam. But it was, I didn't want to put any of that into the Phoenix Program book. You know, the Phoenix Program was about the war on terror, and drugs is about drugs. So they're absolutely connected. They're like Siamese twins. You know, you can't have one without the other. But when I started to, after I finished Phoenix, I decided to write a book about the war on drugs, the first one. And I actually got an interview through some guys who are still my CIA friends, with the head of the acting head of the DEA at the time, a guy named Steve Green. It was 1994. And through his public relations deputy, who was a guy named Bill Ruzzamente. Ruzzamente liked me. And so Steve Green didn't want to do an interview with me. He was the acting director of the DEA, but this guy Ruzzamente liked me. And so he forced Green to do it. And I went down to Pentagon City, which is where the DEA building was. And I took a train down there. I flew in, and I had two suitcases with me because I was going to be down in Washington for about 2 weeks. And it was the winter, so I had a big, heavy winter coat. And I had these, and I went from the airport by a train right to the DEA office in 1994. And I walk into the DEA building. I have two suitcases, and I have all these clothes on. I mean, you can't do that anymore. You know, I mean, you can't walk into any federal building carrying two suitcases anymore. I hope you understand. And I walk in, you know, and they got a guy at the desk, and he says, "What do you want?" And I said, "Well, I'm here to see Ruzzamente." And he said, "Okay, I'll get him." And he calls up to the 17th floor, and Ruzzamente comes down, and I get onto the elevator with my suitcases. You know, I mean, it didn't give me a badge or, you know, a nameplate, you know. And we ride up to the 17th floor, and I walk in and take off my clothes, put my bags down in the director's office, and it's a suite of offices. And the first thing that Ruzzamente said to me after I got a cup of coffee was, "The CIA called me up yesterday. He said, if you ever tell anybody this, I'll deny I ever said it. He said, but the CIA called up yesterday. They knew they're coming. They knew you were coming to see Green. And they said to us, don't let Valentine talk to Green. Valentine's using you, the DEA, because he's trying to get at us, the CIA. He's been doing it, and he does it all over the place. Don't let him do it. Don't let him do the interview." And Ruzzamente looks at me and says, "So what do you have to say about that?" And I said, "Well, I'm doing a book about the DEA, but if I happen to find out in the course of my research that the CIA was somehow involved in drug trafficking or obstructing the DEA, I'm going to write about it." And he said, "Great, that's exactly what I wanted to hear." There was a group of DEA agents at that time that were resisting the CIA. The CIA was infiltrating the DEA, just like I told you, like how they tried to get me, you know, to corrupt me. And they were trying to do it, and there was a diminishing group of DEA agents headed by Ruzzamenti at that time that were resisting, and they were glad that I was going to write a book about it. But that was 22 years ago. And just like we talked about how Mockingbird has evolved, well, the DEA has evolved. And there are no more people in the DEA who are resisting the CIA. CIA has completely taken over. And it's taken over U.S. Customs, and it's taken over ICE, and it's taken over the Justice Department, and it's taken over every branch of the government. And they've done it because it's of the war on terror has been a justification for doing this. And they've even, you know, gotten in to the fusion centers that the Department of Homeland, you know, they created this Department of Homeland Security, which is basically the same thing as the Phoenix program, but here in the United States. And I talk a lot about that in my latest book. And if you want to know how it works, and if you've listened to this interview and you some of it's sunk in, you know, then go read this book that I wrote, and you'll see how the CIA has corrupted just everything and everything it's touched, and it's done so not for your benefit.
Yes, there's no way we can get into the detail and go as in depth into these issues in this one particular interview than you do in your books. So I urge everyone who's listening to this to go out and purchase his books, particularly the new one, "The CIA as Organized Crime: How Illegal Operations Corrupt America and the World," and also his books on the war on drugs. That's "The Strength of the Wolf" and "The Strength of the Pack." And also his book, "The Phoenix Program." And if you read those books, you know, within a year, you'll get a pretty good understanding of how the world works and what we're dealing with. So I want to thank you, Doug, for coming on the show. I think the amount of time we had,
you're very welcome. Yeah. I look forward to our next chat.
Great. Yeah, we'll talk again soon. I'll, you know, let you get on with the afternoon and enjoy the rest of your holiday. And we'll go from there. Thank you. Thank you. And that's DougValentine.com, correct?
DouglasValentine.com.
Yeah. DouglasValentine.com. Great. Well, thank you.
And all right. Bye-bye.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.